Thank you very much. So,
good morning, everyone. Good morning, sir. Professor Sandeep Puri has joined us from the Philippines. And we have the co-chair of the center, Professor Aditya Mishra, here. So this is the second day of the summit, and I hope it was a learning experience for your 2 days. And I wish to participate that today will be also a very learning experience. So over to you, sir. And
thank you, Professor Sakshi. And good morning and welcome to all. I welcome you all to ISMC, International Summit for Management Cases. And among us today, we have a great personality, great academician, and a case writer, excellent case writer. I would say excellent case writer, because the profile which is there for Professor Puri itself suggests that, you know, he doesn't need any introduction actually. But sir, this is the formality. I have to introduce you. So if I go for the formality, then here we have Professor Sandeep Puri, who got more than 27 years of work ex in industry and teaching. Professor Sandeep specializes in sales and marketing. Presently, he is a professor at Asian Institute of Management, Philippines. Before this, he has worked at IMT Ghaziabad, Trident, and Novartis in India. He has significant publications to his credit, with 2 publications in Harvard Business Review. We are still dreaming about that, sir. Hope after your session, we will be able to also, we will also be able to write for HBR. He has more than 75 case studies published with IV Publishing, WDI Publishing, and IMD, Lucene. He has also published articles and research papers in magazines, newspapers, and international journals, respectively. His book on sales and distribution management, co-authored with Still, Kandif, and Govani, is published with Pearson. He is a visiting faculty at business schools like SPJAN, Singapore, Fessel Vorarlberg in Austria, Varna University of Management in Bulgaria, IMT Dubai, Jagdish Seth School of Management, IIM Vizag, IMT Nagpur, Thapar University, and Great Lakes in India. He has conducted many FDPs on case writing and case teaching. I, in behalf of Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center for Leadership, Policy, and Governance, and IIM Ranchi, welcome you for this session. And I along with other participants, look forward for great learning from your experience, sir. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Aditya, for your kind words. Thanks a lot, Sakshi, for inviting me also. Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. Philippines is a beautiful country, so I invite all of you to come here whenever things are better. Okay, so we are in the second day of the summit. This is going to be the agenda which I'm going to cover in the next 80 minutes. So I will share something about my journey, then we'll talk something about a case study. Then I'm taking a few examples of case studies. We can think about giving time to it, or we can even reduce giving time to it. The third case study, your star salesperson light, is my HBR case. So I can tell you how it got published. We'll spend some time on case writing process, and then I'm open to question and answers. Aditya has already introduced me, but this is how typically I introduce myself. So, these are the 4 pillars of my life. My father left for his heavenly abode last month, but whatever I am today, I am because of him. So Aditya has already explained, I worked for 27 years. I started my career with Novartis, then I worked for Trident, IMT Ghaziabad. I'm also alumni of IMT Ghaziabad. And then I'm working at AIM from the last 3.5 years. I have been a visiting scholar at Georgia Tech. I was working with Professor Ajay Kohli. I also got a chance to attend a course of Professor V. Kumar for CRM. They were really very good learnings. I have done a course on sales management at Kellogg. I've also done master teacher program from ISB, the very first batch of master teacher program. I have a few publications with IV Publishing. They're listed with Harvard Business Publishing. I do have publication with Harvard Business Review, and I was jury member for L'Oréal Brainstorm competition at Paris way back in 2016. It was really a very good experience. In case I am not reading or teaching, then it means I am watching a movie or something like this. These movies have a very close relationship with my own life, so they are very close to my heart. These are my favorite books. I typically give books to the students who score highest marks in my classes. So I keep on giving, rotating between these two books. I work for Novartis, so it's a Swiss pharmaceutical. So in case, one wish which I surely have is if I have to get retirement, then I think it's a beautiful country to settle after retirement. I'm typically a Punjabi guy in terms of the food habits. Tandoori chicken, matar paneer. So in case you're thinking of inviting me anytime, I'm giving you the choice of the things, right? And I feel that a day is a good day if it is ending with beer and music. And this is a mantra of my life, that God has given us two hands. One is for helping ourselves and the other is for helping others. And I try to follow this. I typically say thanks to these two people. Dr. B.S. Sahai, he was the director who hired me at IMT Ghaziabad. And Dr. Pravinder Arora, he's in Canada now. He was a professor and he recommended my name to Professor Sahai for the job way back in 2007. Right, so I have around 73 cases listed with Harvard Business Publishing over the last 9 years. I have 6 cases listed with even WDI Publishing, which is the arm of University of Michigan. And I do have a case with even IMD Lausanne in that case. These are my two HBR publication. The first one happened way back in June 2016. Second, September, October 2019. But I must say that between these two submissions, I had 22 rejections. First of all, HBR, they don't allow you to publish another case study for next 12 months. But you know, once you get the feel of the blood that, okay, I have one HBR publication. So whenever a good idea was coming to my mind, I used to write 2 pages on it and I used to send it to HBR team. But even after rejections, never stopped trying in that case. So this publication after 3 years was my 23rd submission after my submission. Just to tell you how my journey started, basically. You know, my journey started for writing case studies back in September 2018. You know, there was a teacher's day. So I hope I'm audible. Aditya, I'm audible, right?
Sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are.
I'm audible. Yes. Thank you.
Sir, there is, sir, a small. Because sir, there was some kind of bandwidth issue for the last 15 minutes. Please check your side, sir. There is some kind of a bandwidth issue.
Okay. What do you suggest? Shall I switch off my video or we can continue? It's okay now.
Oh, okay, sir. It's okay. But besides, you can share the PPT with us so that in case of it continues, we can share the screen from here, sir.
Okay. Okay. So. Okay, so how my journey started, basically, you know, way back in September 2011, one of our professor at IMT, he got a publication with IB. So we have a very good mess at IMT Ghaziabad. So in the mess, everyone was congratulating him and asking him about the case study. I did the same thing. I congratulated him. I also, by mistake, or fortunately for me, I asked him about the case study. In front of everyone, you know, he simply insulted me that you take care of the placement, you don't know how to write or publish, so better you don't ask these type of questions. I really felt bad that that someone said like this to me in front of other professors. But no issues. I was surely taking care of placements. So on that day, we were having the summer placements were going on in the college. So after summer placements got completed, I went out. I had a beer because I was already disturbed. I came back in the evening. I just went to my room to collect the keys because I was staying at the guest house of IMT. Then a student simply, you know, came there to meet me. And this student asked me to start writing case studies because, and I think whenever I post my publications on Facebook or LinkedIn, I simply tag this student of mine who suggested me to start writing case studies. His name is Parasaran. He is heading CIPLA in USA at this point of time. Very mature person. Just imagine, he passed from IMT Ghaziabad way back in 2012. And then right now he is heading CIPLA there. He has also written many case studies with Professor Sanjeev Parashar. So I think he was the keynote speaker yesterday. So Parasaran was already having experience. And maybe I can say that he's having around 5 IV cases as a student of IMT Ghaziabad. Before I go further, I think we are just 10 or 11 people here. So is it okay if we can have a short introduction so that I know who you are and what are your interests?
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, we have 17 participants, and I may request one by one if you can unmute yourself and introduce, give a brief introduction about yourself, please, sir.
Thank you, thank you. Good morning, sir. My name is Vinay Gudi. I am a chartered accountant, practicing chartered accountant, and professor at Mulund College of Commerce. I completed my MBA from Jamnalal Bajaj. And on the verge of completion of PhD, and I'm very much fascinated by case study method. And the workshop at the first day had actually opened my mind very nicely. And I am Ranchi, done a great job, and I'm looking forward for today's session. Thank you, sir.
Thanks, Vinay. Professor Sar, I think you have already, people know you, but in case you want to say something, Professor Sar.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Ashok sir. I'm a faculty member at School of Management, KIT Bhubaneswar. I'm here for the last 16 years. Prior to that, I worked with Bharat Petroleum, starting as a management trainee, taking early retirement as a marketing manager, where I served for 20 years. I teach strategic management, ethics and social responsibility and pricing. I have taught in most of the functional areas, depending upon the variety of topics. And I'm a very passionate about case study method. I have been writing cases for ECCH, now Case Center, but as somebody else told, since there is no credit in our PBAS as per the UGC, I have actually discontinued publishing there, but I'm highly motivated after the interactions here, irrespective of credit, I think of again getting back to my case writing. Thank you.
Thank Professor Sar. In fact, I must say to you that you should not stop. You know, when I started writing cases, we were not having any credit for even IV cases. But it has really helped me in my career going forward.
That's right. I'll speak to you separately regarding one of your cases which I read and use, the star salesperson, later when you come to it.
Right. Thanks, Professor Sar. Yes, Khushbu. Khushbu?
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, Khushbu.
Good morning, sir. I am Khushbu and I am first year PhD student from IIM Ranchi in economics area. And I am looking forward for this so that I can also implement this college life.
Thanks, Khushbu. Neeraj?
Yes, sir. Sir, good morning, sir. This is Neeraj Kumar Kesarwani from third year PhD strategic management area, IIM Ranchi. I have started working on a few case studies, one of which is under review actually. And whatever mistakes I have done till now, I got through this workshop and I am looking forward to further improve my cases, what I'm doing. And I'm looking forward for your insights and your experience to use further. And looking forward for today's session. Thank you, sir.
Thanks, Neeraj. Prachi? Prachi? Okay, let's go to Prachi.
Prachi is a staff member here at the IIM Ranchi, sir.
Okay. Sorry. Let's go to Prateek. Prateek.
Hello, sir. My name is Prateek Khanna, and I'm a computer engineer currently pursuing my PGEXP course at IIM Ranchi.
Okay. Thanks, Prateek.
Thank Chitta? You.
Very good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, this is Professor Shikta Singh from School of Management, KIT University. I've worked for past now, it's going to be 11 years. And I have been teaching courses on managerial economics, which includes macro and financial management, along with digital finance. So I have, till now, this is a few of these cases which I've sent and I've written and tried over IIM Ranchi. And looking forward from your session, sir. Thanks a lot to IIM Ranchi for giving us this opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Chitta. Thank you very much. Sundar Murthy. Sundar?
Good morning, sir. Actually, I can say that I am a weed to this symposium or summit, because I am basically an agriculture economist who is working with research. So this is my first exposure to a case study, and I think it is a good learning experience for me in the last 2 days.
Thanks, Sundar. Vinay? Vinay?
Sir, I have already introduced.
Okay, sorry, Vinay. Yes, your name is coming again now, because I think you were the first person to say that. Thanks, Vinay. Okay, so if it's okay, I will request you to use your cameras, but otherwise, perfectly fine. Okay, so you have already been exposed to case studies, so I will not spend too much time here. But this is what I feel about a case study. Case is basically a description of a situation, which may be an organization or an institution or a person in that organization is facing. Good cases basically, you know, enable the participants to put themselves in the shoes of the decision maker. And then we typically use them in the business schools to get the participants' understanding of the theory and how they can connect theory with application, right? Case studies also help to develop a practical insight or wisdom. Here at AIM, in case we're having a 20-session course, I think we use around 15 or 16 case studies. So it is typically, AIM was started by Harvard Business School way back in 1968. They started IIM Ahmedabad in India. They started IIMD Lausanne. And this also started Asian Institute of Management. What makes a good case study? You know, nowadays I keep on getting many case studies for review. Some we have to reject because many people, you know, they submit a case study in which they're talking about an issue of 2016, 2017, or even 2018 from that perspective. Right? So not very contemporary in that case. So I will request that in case you're going for a case study publication for finance, yes, there are many cases which are having an old, I will say, the timeline, because in finance you have to have, you know, the financial information, so it cannot be always contemporary. And then there are many practices in finance which are quite, you know, they have not changed. But otherwise, you have to go for a contemporary topic. We'll discuss about my HBR case study. So it's more about, you know, how you can introduce a tension between alternative course of action. So that case study is talking about whether you should fire the salesperson who was a star salesperson of your company. A good case study will also highlight multiple points, viewpoints. You know, so the students are having a neutral and a good information that they can make their decisions. Right? Primarily, I think you should go for one or two core issues. Many times I also see case studies which are having, you know, many complexities. Make your life easier. Go for one or two focus areas and you're going for a case study publication. Yes, a case study should be ambiguous so that you can generate multiple options. That's going to be one thing. Traditional things, when you're writing case study, you should go for a compelling storyline so that, you know, even the participants, they feel about the characters. A good case study should be such a good thing that you can sustain discussion maybe for the whole 80 minutes, or maybe there are professors who used one case study for a period of 3 or 4 sessions. Right? Present a puzzle that hingers with participants long after case discussion is over. You know, please keep one thing in mind. I was listening to a professor of Harvard. He was saying that why they have so many case studies. They simply say that at Harvard, they use around 500 or 600 case studies in one MBA course. It means they are exposing their students to 500 or 600 business situations. So going forward in their life, they are prepared that they may get some similar situations. Now, in this case, we need to have some really good cases who are bringing that point of view, that students do remember the case study even when the discussions are over. Well-structured and easy to read without grammatical mistakes. We'll discuss about it. You know, many times, in case you're writing a case study and you feel that there are 2 pages with one single heading, I will simply request you to have some subheadings in that case. Because when you have, you know, when you go for 2 pages in one heading, students simply start getting, you know, restless. They don't like to read so much. So I think it's easier to make subheadings with the suitable titles and then give idea to students accordingly. This was my first case study, which got published way back in 2013. It was one of the best seller on Harvard Business Publishing website. I feel good about this case study because I just submitted one more case study, not of this company, but another company, but it was almost similar, you know, situation. This pharmaceutical company on which I have written a case study now, this company is also having the same problem that for the first 3 quarters, their sales were not good because of COVID last year. And then they were thinking of launching Fabiflu for COVID. But then their salespeople are saying that we are already pressurized for the sales. Don't launch the product at this point of time. So this case study, which I have just submitted, is talking about 2 issues. It's about product and brand management during pandemic, and it's also about the sales target dilemma. These are 2 cases which I'm going to spend some time on. I will not get into details of these cases. So there's a case study which is on Serva Pharmaceuticals in Cambodia, Phytofold. This was basically a consulting project which I did for this company. This case study is having this content. The very first paragraph is talking about the dilemma of the company. What is happening in this company? This company is doing very well. They have their operations in India, Philippines, and Cambodia. The company is making profits overall. But in Cambodia, this company is having 2 units. One is distribution arm. They simply procure the medicine from India and they distribute it to the marketing companies. That's all. But they have their own marketing unit also. But what is happening in the marketing unit is that the sales are going down. The salespeople are selling easy to sell products. So we have covered all these things. So there's an issue of sales leadership. There's an issue of wrong segmentation of customers. Right. So this is a very complex case study from that perspective, but I have kept it very simple. This is the only title which are there. Introduction, then company background. So we're talking about sales and marketing. We're talking about distribution and promotion. And we're talking about the future international expansion plan, because this company is moving into Myanmar also. Then we simply have the next heading is Serva Pharma Cambodia. We have discussed about Serva Pharma Cambodia. Then there are 2 headings, subheading basically. One is Serva Pharma Marketing. What they are doing, how many products they have, right? Exhibits, we have given the details of their products with profit margins. And then there's one subsection, which is on John Tayang, who is country head. And there's basically a problem with this person itself. Because this person came from, he's a Cambodian who was working in the Philippines as an area manager. But then this company appointed him as the national sales manager. Now this person doesn't have that experience of really leading a company from the national perspective. Then we are talking about the pharmaceutical industry in Cambodia. It is important to write about this because the pharmaceutical industry in Cambodia is growing. So in case the company is thinking about not to go for, you know, their marketing unit, it may be a wrong idea. So a company should go ahead with their marketing unit. And then we are talking about the different challenges for Serva marketing unit. Right? So we are talking about sales leadership and we are talking about challenges for a Sarvad marketing. These are the questions which I have asked in this case study. So what were John Tayang's critical failures with control of the Salesforce and what are the possible implications? You know, many times people keep on saying that there has to be some frameworks which should be used. So my purpose of sharing this case study with you is, in this case study, we have not used any framework. This is more like a consulting case study. And even if you look at the teaching of this case study, we are talking about prioritizations. Okay? Whether, now there are many options, right? Third question is about service considering several options to strengthen its marketing function. What is a good starting point? In this case, in case there are five action the company is going to take, we have divided them into low priority, low investment. Okay, high priority, high investment. So we have also talking about risk mitigation in those things. Fourth question is how the company can modify its sales strategy and align it with its marketing strategy. And then what are the other possible strategies which the company can use to turn around the company? This is another case study, which is Ajanta Packaging. It's on key account management. Now what's happening in this case study is, this company is, Ajanta Packaging is selling their products to Patanjali, Biba, Cavenders, many other companies in India. It's a glass, they supply glass bottles. Now they're having one very big client. I cannot name the client, so we have disguised the name of the client as SF Foods. Now SF Food is giving around 60% of its business to Ajanta Packaging. It means Ajanta Packaging is number one distributor of SF Foods. Second thing which is happening is around 15% of business of Ajanta Packaging is coming from SF Foods. They started their relationship way back in 2003, but in the last 18 years, the relationship has evolved. Surely Ajanta is their number one vendor for glass bottles, but SF Foods has started behaving like Walmart. They have reduced the margins for Ajanta Packaging, one thing. Second thing is they are asking for delivery at a faster rate. Third thing is they are also delaying the payments. Delayed payments means margins are further going down. Now, at one point of time, way back in October, Ajanta Packaging is already having an order from SF Foods. It's a 50 million order. They also have orders of worth rupees 90 million from other companies. In case they supply the order to SF Food, they are going to default on the other orders on which they have a profitability of 10%. Now, this case study is all about a key account management in that case. Right? Again, in case you read the case study, it's not very complex. We're talking about company background. We're talking about Indian packaging industry, glass bottle industry. What are the challenges? Because this is impacting the profitability of the company. Then we're talking about key account management at Ajanta. And then we're talking about the relationship between SF Foods and Ajanta Packaging. And we are also writing about SF Foods that this company is already operating in so many countries, and they're also thinking of moving into some new countries. Right? So, in case you look at this particular case study, this is again a bestseller on Harvard Business Publishing, contemporary case study. Any professor who is teaching CRM can simply use this case study, or even for sales management, can use this case study for B2B selling, for B2B marketing, and key account management. This was a case study which Professor Sar was talking about. This was my second HBR publication. I must say that my first HBR publication happened because of an invite. It may happen with some of you that you send your case studies to HBR and it may get rejected because in the initial stages, HBR, they publish case studies of professors of Harvard Business School. And many times the editors of Harvard Business School, basically Harvard Business Review, they keep on reading the case studies written by other authors. So my first case study, which was Expand the Menu, it happened because of an invite. I got a call from the editor of the Harvard Business Review that they want to write a case study. So it was the best moment of my life. I was traveling in Delhi Metro and I got that call. It's a second case study you're talking about. What is happening in this case study? This case study is more about that there are There is a sales representative who is a star sales representative of the company, Uday. And this sales representative is doing well. He is being, you know, highlighted by the company at different meetings as the best sales representative, the role model of the company. Now, the sales representative Uday is being blessed with a baby boy. And, you know, we all understand that in the initial days, once you have a kid, your days are short and your nights are long. Now, what has happened in this case that Uday submitted a report of meeting a customer on a particular day. But this customer posted on Facebook that this customer is watching a World Cup match somewhere else. The post which even Shadda, the sales manager, also saw. Now, the customer cannot be at two places on the same day in that case. So there's a very valid proof that Uday has submitted a false report. Right. Now, the question is whether this company should fire Uday or this company should retain Uday in that case. I must say that whenever I show this image, I love this particular image. Now, this was a disguise case study. So I have used my son's name. My son is Siddhant. My daughter is Shraddha. Okay, Uday was my boss actually when I was working with Novartis, and Bhavna is the name of my wife. So I have used their names in this case study. Now, this is a disguise case study, but I have shared, when I was sharing the case study with Harvard Business Review, I shared the actual case study with Harvard Business Review. Right? This is a real incidence which happened in a friend's company. So it's not a real case, but Harvard Business Review, they don't publish the cases with those companies. They simply want to avoid any issues. So they simply disguise the case study. Now, in case you look at the name of the company in this case study, it is NovaSafe. So basically, when I started working, I joined basically Ciba Geigy. So Ciba Geigy is a company which got merged with Sandoz at a later date, and it became Novartis. So I use a combination of Novartis and Ciba Geigy as NovaSafe. And you know, we also did some research because it was a HBR publication. So we also did a research that in case we give the same case study to senior managers, what is going to be their response, right? And this is the major reason that this case is published with Harvard Business Review. 54% of the respondents in that around 328 people who responded to that survey, 54% were saying that they are going to fire the salesperson. 46% said that they are going to retain the salesperson. It means it's a very strong dilemma. It's not like this that 90% of people are saying that they are going to retain the salespeople or they are going to fire the salesperson. So this case study was having different perspectives. You know, do you want to fire a salesperson who was good, who recently became father and he has admitted to his mistake, or you want to go with a strategy that an ethical breach is an ethical breach? Whosoever it may be, we have to fire the salesperson. So it's a Harvard Business Review case study. So there's no teaching note in this case study, but it is being used in many courses. And we do ask some of these type of questions when we are going for this case study. I use this case study for design thinking program, right? So define the problem in the case and suggest the possible causes. Should they get a second chance? Identify alternative courses of action and suggest a possible solution. And then what systems can be implemented by the company to avoid such incidences in the future? Anyone, any questions so far?
Yes, sir. Can I have a question?
Sure, Professor Ashok.
So what actually happened to Uday? Is it proper to share? Was he actually fired?
No, Professor Uday. Sorry, Professor Ashok. Uday was not fired.
Okay.
Now, in this case also, you know, I must say a few things here. 54% of the people who wanted to fire the salesperson, they were all working for multinational companies and they were having profiles like marketing managers, HR managers, finance controllers, or someone like this. 46% of the people who don't want to fire the salesperson, they were basically from sales, working for smaller companies. And they understand that, okay, such things can happen in sales. So he should be given a second chance. That the original company here also was having its operation only in Maharashtra. They have around 50 employees. Uday was giving them very good sales. So firing Uday would have really affected the company's sales and profitability. So they decided not to fire.
Okay. Thank you.
Right, Professor Shah. Okay. So let us spend some time on case setting process from how I look at the things. This is a process which I have followed in my career. So it's more about idea. Many times the idea comes from, in case I'm teaching a course, I feel that, okay, there is a session on which there is no contemporary case study. And then I think about the coverage. What are the things which I want my students to learn in that particular session? Many times the idea do come from the other sources. I read a newspaper and there's a newspaper, news about launch of a particular product or a controversy, that can also be your ideas. Second thing is going to be the planning, where you simply plan about what is going to be the content of the case. Then you go for your writing. If possible, I typically do try the cases before submitting it to IAB or IMD. I try it in my classes. Okay. After your class trial, you can simply review some of the missing links. Right, and then you can go for your publishing. So idea generation. Yes, you can surely go through newspapers, online class discussions. Some of my case studies, in fact, are based on class discussions. We have published a case study on Unilever launching Dove range of baby care products way back in 2013. You know, we submitted that case study to IAB. IB people simply declined to publish that case study because they were saying that this may be an insider information, but there was nothing like this. This was simply my students for a marketing management project. They presented that Dove as a brand can enter into baby care sector. And finally, in 2018, Dove has launched their baby care range, but we wrote that case study about possibility of launching that product range way back into 2013. Some of my case studies are based on interviews that I was meeting an alumni, and then I got to know about something which was giving sleepless night. I typically ask people when they had sleepless night because of any managerial issues. You know, Aditya, you were asking about HBR cases. My last case, the star salesperson, happened because I was having a beer with one of my friends. And that friend of mine was passing through a difficult phase to take a decision on Uday. So, you know, I had beer with him. I came back home at around maybe 12 in the midnight. And then at midnight only, I wrote that case study. In the morning, I simply had, a good look at it. I also did the software. I use software for my copy editing things. It's basically Grammarly. So I checked it there and then I submitted to HBR. And I must say that I was very lucky that within 24 hours, I got acceptance from HBR. Second part is going to be, you know, many times it has happened that you want to write on something, but not good amount of information is available on internet or something like this. So you have to, that is your planning part, that whatever you want to write, is it possible for you to get enough information from different sources to write about those cases? So in case I'm having how many, around 81 cases, if I include ECCH, then I am having around 87 cases, but majority of my cases are basically published source cases, secondary source cases, right? But in this case, you have to go for credible websites or newspapers. Right? Those are going to be the things. Sometimes, yes, you can disguise the case studies. Some of my case studies, I started writing a case study with a company, but my contact left the company when I finished the case study, so I could not get the permission from the company to publish the case study. Then I have, gone ahead with disguising the case study. Just my suggestion in that case, in case you're writing a case study which is going to be disguised, you have to make many changes. So I wrote a case study on a bank in India, but ultimately we changed the country, we changed the bank. So we changed everything in that case. There were a few customers who were involved. We have changed the name of the customer and everything, the manager and everything in that case. Okay. Because many times all the good publishing houses, they say that, you know, even if you're trying to disguise, the data is clearly giving an idea that this is the company you're talking about. Field research, I will say that surely it's challenging because you have to meet the demand of different stakeholders of the company here, but the possibility of getting a selection of a field research case study is much higher as compared to other cases. I don't think even a single case of mine on the basis of field research has ever got rejected. All my rejections so far are basically secondary source cases. Planning the case study. Now, we are here from different departments, right? So, you know, there are things you have to do. Which content you're going to target, what is going to topic, and you know, how I can use it in one of my sessions. That can be a good starting point when you're thinking about writing a case study. You know, why I am saying so, I've seen many times that a professor who is actually a marketing professor is thinking about writing a case study on IT area because he feels that there's a very good news in the market, collaboration between Facebook and Enterlines. So let's write a case study from that perspective. You know, we need to understand that in case I want to write a case study with an IT perspective, I will request my faculty colleagues from the IT area to partner with me in that case because they are more competent than me to understand the different frameworks which are used in an IT strategy course, or same thing even for finance course or operation management course. In case you are writing it alone, go for it, your area of expertise. Recently, I'm writing a case study with it's on Swiggy and HR issues. You know, one professor from MIT discussed it with me. I said we can surely write it. But let me involve one more professor from IMT who is expert in HR area. So she can be our partner or co-author for writing this case study because they are more competent for writing a case study on HR issues. These are my recent case studies which got accepted. One is on Amazon Food. I've written this with a professor from Great Lakes. That we have a professor from IB also who is involved in this Amazon Food case study. The other case study is about Google acquisition of Fitbit. Now, both these case studies are basically written on the basis of public sources. Writing the case study, first of all, collect information as much as you can to further research about the company, about the different issues, about anything which is happening related to your case topic. I typically go for developing a caselet. Caselet means I develop a one-page case study with learning objectives, and then I try it in my class, and then I get into other things. I will also request you that you please write your case study as your teaching note simultaneously. Why I am saying so? You know, many times it does happen that after writing the case study, we start writing the teaching note, and we realize that additional information is required to answer those questions. So in case you have the question in your mind and the possible short answers at the start itself, it will help you to really write a good case study going forward. I'm just showing you a caselet which I have converted from a caselet to a case study. This is a caselet, you can simply say here, right? I show this caselet to the students. I just simply display on the blackboard so students can see it, and then I simply ask them to go for the analysis, right? Now basically here the question is, can Amber sell these towels at 190 per kilogram? What could be the minimum possible rate to sell the towels? This case study basically like this. I have given them the idea about fixed cost, variable cost, profit, tax, right? So the total cost per kg of selling the towel is 2247 pesos, right? Now they have got an order. Now this company is asking them to sell at 190. Now something which I feel that in case I just keep 10% profit, I'm having 247.6 as the cost. So in case I remove my profit here, the cost is still 227. So shall I sell these towels at 190? This case study, on one hand, this is a one pager case study, but I use it in my pricing strategy class for marketing management. And we typically spend around 60 to 70 minutes on this case study. I introduce all those concepts of target pricing. I talk about break even, right? We also talk about how pricing can affect the other things in the company, right? So one pager, but then it's very good discussion in the class. Anyone, any question here?
Is this case study available in any publication?
Professor, this is still under publication process. It will be available soon.
Okay, thank you.
Professor Puri, Anshuman here. I'm also an assistant professor here. I am Ranchi. And I just wanted to ask you. So you have talked about the secondary data cases. So is it always required to have permission from the company even to publish secondary data cases, or are they published without a formal permission from the company?
Okay. Thanks, Anshuman. Good question. I don't know why nobody asked it earlier. I was expecting this question. So Anshuman, what is happening for all those cases which are based on published sources, there is no need to have any permission from the company. The only issue in this case of published cases is that for everything, whatever you are mentioning, every data point, you have to give a reference. So that is many of my cases which are written on the basis of published sources are having around 120 footnotes. Whereas my cases which are published on the basis of information from the company are having only 15 or 20 footnotes. Because in those cases of field research, you can always say that company, this is according to the company database. Right, so I can simply write a line like this, that the owner of DJ Towels said that the market of towels all over the world is approximately 200 billion, right? I need not to give any reference for that. But whenever I'm writing a case study on the basis of published sources, you have to get all those details for information. And many times you have to match those details with a case timeline. That is also sometimes a tricky situation, that you're writing a case study in the timeline of October 2020. You have market data which is talking about either 2020, it is published in December, or you're having a report which is published in March. So how you're really going to make it updated and those type of things, right? So these are the issues which we face, but I go for many published source cases, because whenever you want to write for a very good company. So one of my bestsellers is United Airlines. We also have a very good case study, which is on Coca-Cola. They are published sources. Ajanta Packaging is also best-selling, but that is the only case which in my portfolio, which is the bestseller case, which is written on the basis of field research. Is it okay, Anshuman? Thanks, Anshuman. Okay, so you can also think about developing a case study like this for your classes, right in the class. Many times your students will also give some very good inputs which you can think about considering in your teaching mode. Writing the case study. Now I will simply request all of you that make it sure that you write everything in the past tense. Even when you say that honesty is the best policy, it's not going to be. It's going to be honesty was the best policy, right? So everything, whichever, maybe you feel that it's best, because the case study which you're writing in 2014, 2021 is going to be used maybe in 2027 also. So that's why it's important for us to make it sure that it is in the past tense only. Yes, quotations you can use in the present tense. Next thing is, the case study which you were thinking about writing, I think my request to all of you is that don't look at only the purpose of writing a case study. Are you going to use that case study in your own class? Right? In case that's going to be a reason for you to write a case study, I will say that one of the best cases which I have written, they are basically the cases which I have used in my classes. Opening paragraph, right? Many people have, you know, typically in case I show you my case studies, I have very short intro paragraphs. But in this case, I am introducing who is the main protagonist, who is the key decision maker, what is the nature of the issue or problem, when did the case take place? It's more about timeline, right? Where did the case take place? And then why did that problem or the issue, it came into the picture? Now, this was a case about Sarva Pharmaceutical I was talking about. Now, this case, I have introduced it with a quotation from Michael Porter, and then it's a 3-page introductory paragraph, and I have introduced everything. In case you read these 3 paragraphs, you will understand the problem of the case study itself. Many times when I take sessions for the students, how to prepare for the case analysis, I simply ask them to give lots of emphasis to the starting of the case study and the end part of the case study. And then looking at the questions which the professor might have given to them or the subject where it is going to be discussed, the students can, you know, concentrate on some of the additional areas. This is Ajanta packaging. Yes, anyone? Shri, you want to ask something? Right, so Ajanta packaging also, these 4 paragraphs are covering everything which is there in the case study. The next thing is going to be your body of the case. So now in this case, you have to go for the whole story. The components which are required for the students to answer the different questions or to solve the case study. Whenever you're getting into company background or market analysis, I will request that please go for chronological order. So many times in case you look at the case study formats, it's more about company background, right? You talk about the industry, major players, growth factors, challenges of the industry, and then you talk about customers, evolving customer behavior or something like this, right? And then details of the specific issues faced by the company. I will request that I was reviewing a case study for Emerald, and then these authors are taking sides, which is basically they are giving a hint that this should be the answer also, right? I will request that you please go for both sides of the story. Make it neutral from that perspective. You know, in case the answers are obvious for the students, that will never be a good case study. The concluding paragraph, again, it should provide a short synthesis of what the case is all about, the main issues, right? Many times, at least what I do in my cases, I try to link my last paragraph with the introductory part of the case study. Surely you have to go for different wording. I have reviewed some cases where what they have mentioned in the introductory part of the case study, they have simply copied paste at the end of the case study. It doesn't serve the purpose. I've also seen few case studies where people are simply copy pasting the introductory part of the case study as a synopsis or teaching note, right? So it is not again going to serve the purpose. But I must say that in the concluding part of your case study, you can think about adding the teaching note questions in a different wording. Right. So in this case, if you look at this Sarva Pharma Cambodia case study, I have introduced some of the questions which students need to answer after reading the case study. Right. So he needed to determine whether the company need to restructure the product portfolio, okay, reduce low profit products and introduce more high profit products, right? So we have discussed about it. Or he should shut down Sarva's marketing unit in Cambodia and concentrate only on profitable distribution center, right? So I've tried to cover the questions with a concluding paragraph. this was again in case of Ajanta packaging, where they have to make a decision about the 50 million order of SF Foods, right? What they can do in that case. Dipankar had to decide whether to accept the order of SF Food on their terms or renegotiate the terms to suit Ajanta. He also wondered what processes he could follow to prevent such situations in future. Okay, exhibits are very important. You know, many times I see case studies that people have submitted to some of these publishing houses. They don't have good exhibits. Now, there is a case study where they are talking about sales data that the owner of the company are looking at the sales data, but there is no exhibit about the sales data. And he's saying that the sales are going down and he has to take a decision. Now, this whole decision about sales is being discussed in the case study, but this case study is not having selected financials of the company. This case study is not having any information about how the sales are actually going up or down, maybe month-wise or year-wise, right? So I simply recommended major revision for this case study. So, you know, many times the case study which we write here in India, someone who is studying the case study, maybe in IMD Lausanne or some other places, I have a case study which is published on EcoTasar. It's published with IMD Lausanne, right? So someone who is studying at IMD Lausanne doesn't know where Ranchi is, right? They don't know where Jamshedpur is. So what is recommended here is that you show the map of India and then you put these locations so that the people, students who are outside India, they can also understand where these locations are. Okay. Use diagram charts typically in grayscale. Most of these publishing houses, they don't publish colored exhibits. Right? Exhibits, don't start explaining, please refer exhibit this for this information. It's just like this, that the company, for example, the company reported sales of 200 million in 2020. In the bracket, see exhibit one, where I have given complete details, the sales, profit margins, operating expenses, and everything. Okay. This is something which I will again like to reiterate, that case should highlight practical applications of theory, reflect the ambiguity of the situation. The intent basically, you know, is to bring dialogue in the class, encourage critical thinking, and lead to more research and evaluation of alternatives, right? Again, you have to collect relevant information from your case organization or from publishing sources. And I will also request that while collecting the data, please start having a citations at the same time. Many times we copy something from somewhere, but we forget to write the reference there. It's, you know, you will waste more time just to try to find out from where I got this information. Okay, teaching note. This is a typical format of the teaching note. Talk about case synopsis. As I requested earlier, case synopsis should be based on, you know, it should be an abstract what the case study is all about. Maybe you can introduce what the students are going to learn from this case study. You can also have maybe some linkage with the questions of the teaching note. But please don't simply copy the introductory part here. Target audience, whether this case study is for undergrad, whether it's for, you know, MBA, or it's for executive level courses. Clear learning objectives. That's what I keep on saying, that think about if you have to use this case study, in which session, which course you're going to take, use this course, and how you're going to use this case study. So this is session time. If in case I have 5 questions, it's going to be an 80-minute session. Just suggest you want to give 10 minutes for this question, 15 minutes for this question, or something like this. Suggested readings. In fact, nowadays, all publishing houses are also asking for supplemental material, where they are asking for, you know, you can add some YouTube videos which are available, can be added there about the company, about some of the answers which you're having. For example, your case study is having Michael Porter's 5 force analysis. There's a 10-minute video which is available on YouTube from Harvard Business School. Okay, that can be a supplemental material that the teacher can ask students to see the video before the class to answer a particular question. You have to go for discussion questions and possible answers of those questions. In the HBR, they don't want you to have a teaching note, but other places they want you to have teaching notes. You also have to write about what happened section. So maybe, you know, I wrote a case study in October 2020 timeframe, but right now we are into May 2021 or June 2021. You have to write about what actually happened in that case. Just like Professor Sar asked me about whether the company hired or, you know, fired a salesperson. In case you're writing a finance case study, it's always better to give worksheets. I have a worksheet for a case study, which is on customer lifetime value, right? I already discussed about the links to videos. Okay, trial of the case study is something which I strongly recommend, but many of you are still doing your PhD. So in case that's a case that you are a PhD student, if it's possible for you to try that case study in your mentor's class, go for it. Otherwise, not compulsory. So try the case and revise the content. Next step is reviewing. Reviewing in the sense, reviewing before submission. Citations is a big issue I have seen when I look at some of the case studies. Right. My first request: please don't go for wiki references. Wiki references are not allowed at good publishing houses. Please make it sure that when I write for journals, they simply want to go for footnotes. When I write for IMD Lausanne or IB Publishing, they want to go for endnotes. Personally, I prefer to go for endnotes because, you know, student starts counting how many pages are there in the case study. So when you go for the endnotes, it simply means like this. For example, for a case study, when I was talking about Anshuman's answer, that I'm having around 120 footnotes, that case study is having 3 pages of references. Including the 3 pages, that case study is a 13-page case study. But my actual case study is just 10 pages. And in case you remove those exhibits, it may be a 7-page case study. One more thing, no incomplete references. What happens? Many people submit their case study without looking into these minor details. They submit it to the publishing houses. You know, once you submit your case study, they will take around 6 to 8 weeks to respond to you for the first review. And unfortunately, many times we have to recommend that this is copywriting is required, proofreading is required, citations is not proper. So you will have to go through all these things. And it will take 2 more months to really come back to the same level. So spending 3 days on making the citations as per the requirement of the publishing house is very important. Right. So I'll simply give some example here. In case you're talking about references of websites and online news sources, you have to go for something like this: the author, title of the news item, where it is published, in those times, the date of publication, right? When you accessed it, and then the link. You talk about databases, you have to go for the name of the company, which database you're talking about, etiquette at online, and we're talking about Form 10K here, right? And you can simply talk about accessed here. You cannot give a link here because the link may not work for someone else, right? Corporate documents, again, name of the company, summary report 2019, when you access it, and the link of that available report. Before you submit, I will simply say that please check submission guidelines. Check for possible errors. I will recommend that for many case studies, I do pay for proofreading and copy editing. It's always a better idea to go for proofreading and copy editing instead of making those mistakes. And then again, you get a letter from us. No incomplete references. I would also request you people that please go for an even plagiarism check when you're working with someone else. It has happened with me that I had these type of incidences that I submitted a case study with another author with whom I was working for the first time. Then I got an email from IV that Sandeep, this part is totally copied from the source. There's not even a single change here. You know, it's not a good thing for your own reputation in that case. So nothing wrong. I think all of us do have done it in or whatever, maybe the plagiarism checkers. Please do check it to make it sure that things are taken care of. Yes, in case it's a published field research case, you have to take a consent form from the company. These are the common mistakes which we do while writing case studies. written as a research article, not as a case study, right? There is no need to write, you know, in the bracket, Porter 2008. This is not going to be a thing which is going to happen in the case studies. Simply read some case studies in case you're writing case study for the first time. Okay, grammatical mistakes, taking sides, not following the instructions. People go for different styles of, you know, few publishing houses go for APA style, someone go for Chicago pattern. So you have to see that you're following the right pattern in this case. Lack of fit. Let's say lack of fit. In case, you know, I wrote a case study on Swachh Bharat Abhiyan way back in 2014. It got rejected with IV, but then we left it as it is. We wrote another case study, which was about a business school, right? Again, it was rejected because they don't want to, you know, glorify another business school. So they don't, such type of case study, they don't get published. Okay, lack of permission documents, again, plagiarism and improper citations. In the teaching note, the problem is that in case I want to use this particular case study, enough information, you're talking about segmentation and targeting for marketing students, but they are not given any idea about the customer profile, right? So it is difficult to answer some of those things. Many times people do suggest answers which are there in the case teaching note, but you have not mentioned about possible those things in your alternatives in the case study itself. Don't go for models without a purpose. You know, maybe I was lucky that when I used all these Porter 5 courses way back in 2013, 14, very few people were writing case studies. But nowadays, many people are writing case studies. So you have to go for contemporary models. In case you want to go Porter 5 courses, you know, make it look better. Can you bring quantification there? It should be a good analysis. Okay. Many people do submit case studies without sample answers. That is also not a good thing. No analysis, or, you know, when you're getting into your teaching note, you should have sufficient depth in the answers. That is an important point here. Working together, I will simply suggest that work with a compatible team. I have seen that there are a few people who started writing something together, but they could not finish it because the team was not compatible. They had their own issues, right? The ego issues predominantly. Exploit your individual strengths. So that's what I was saying, that in case it's a case study which is having a combination of marketing and HR, I will concentrate on marketing part, but I will request a professor from HR area to join me and work on that part. I think it's better to clarify the order of appearance from the first meeting itself. The funda which I use is whosoever has worked more on the case study should be the first author. It is back to the fact that he's a PhD student or the faculty mentor. I learned this thing from Professor Ajay Kohli. He was editor of Journal of Marketing. I think he doesn't need any introduction. I worked with him. I have some publication with him. In those publications, my name is coming first. Professor Ajay Kohli, who is, I really respect him a lot. He's second author. First time when I wrote a case study with him, I went to him with a draft. He said to me, Sandeep, you are the first person in this case study. But maybe I thought that he's saying I have not changed it. I went to him next time. He said that, Sandeep, first of all, change this name sequence. If you come up with another draft of the same sequence, I'm not going to be a part of this case study. He was very clear in that case. Right? So I learned from him that whosoever is working more should be having his name or her name coming first in the case study, right? That's a principle which you people can think about following. I'm sorry, in case you are a PhD advisor. Okay, I will also request that please work on track changes mode so that your co-authors can see the changes which you are making in the files. Finally, you're into the publishing process, right? These are the few things which you can get. If you're very lucky, you will get acceptance as your first response. Most of my cases, I go for minor revisions. This Fitbit case, it was a major revision. Then yes, I do have rejections, right? So all these four things can happen with all of you, right? So in case you're getting a revision, simply thank the persons, right? And then start working on the comments. Sometimes, you know, the comments can be sharp, but keep that in mind that they are not personal. they are just about that they should not be done like this. Reviewers have their own way of writing the things. That's what I was talking about, that revision. Thanks the editor and go for the revision. You know, at some places it can happen that you have written something, but the reviewer is having a different point of view, and you feel that you need to go ahead with your point of view. I think you need to simply clarify there. I would typically prefer that you meet the deadlines, because the reviewers also, you know, they read the case study. In case you're submitting the case study way back after 3 or 4 months, even the reviewer, they have lost interest and they don't remember about the case study. Again, revise under track changes mode so that the publishing coordinators can see whether you have made the changes. But it all depends upon the publishing house. Journals don't ask you to work in the track changes mode, because that can reveal the identity of the author. Your case can also get rejected, right? So don't give up. I have 7 or 8 cases which are good case studies from my perspective. They got rejected, right? The first thing which I do typically is I work on it and I resubmit. I don't change the publishing house or the journal simply because it got rejected, right? But sometimes it has happened that even after working on it, even after revising it, I am unable to meet the requirement of the publishing house, right? I go for another source. I simply don't leave a case study after working on it. So this is a case plan which we use at AIM. We simply have this type of a plan. What are the possible title? Who are going to be the case writers, right? Case lead, what is the setting of the case study? What are the issue or problem? Who is the protagonist? And then positioning, right? We talk about target audience, courses, learning objectives, brief outline of the case, data requirements, milestones, right? People can follow the same strategy in that case. Okay, my time is getting over, so let me quickly go to other things. Okay. You people are lucky that you're getting opportunity to write, attend summit like this. I think all of you should be thankful to I'm Ranchi and the team for organizing this summit. My request to all of you is that you have already attended one day, so you're also attending it today. In the evening, you should start thinking about your first case study in case you're writing it for the first time. That, you know, I'm going to make use of this particular workshop. So started today from that perspective, you have to take the responsibility. Okay, make it a passion in case you want to write. I think you have to make it a passion whether you want to write research papers or case studies, whatever it may be. I will simply request that please read more case studies. That's how you will learn how to write case studies, right? Workshops, 1 or 2 workshops are sufficient to set the ground rules. And after that, you should go on your own. Network, your professors can be a great help. Your friends in the industry can be a great help. Okay, your other contacts, they can be really a good help to write the case studies. Find a mentor in case you are starting your journey. And please, you know, sequence doesn't make a difference. That's what Professor Kohli told me, as long as you're getting a good case study publication. Okay. This is how my journey looks like in case I talk about it. I studied from a Punjabi medium school in Jalandhar. So that was my background, that I have to translate everything from, you know, in my earlier days of my career, I used to think in Punjabi or Hindi and then translate in English and then speak. When I was working at IMT Ghaziabad, I was staying at Dwarka in Delhi. I was traveling for 5 hours in a day. But out of those 5 hours, I was spending around 4 hours in Delhi Metro. And what I did in those 4 hours, I was simply writing case studies. And I was writing case studies when there was no incentives, nothing else was there to really promote case studies. But I must say that I'm working at Asian Institute of Management now. I have my professor colleagues who have done their PhD from Wharton, Harvard. I have many colleagues, 3 colleagues, in fact, who have done their MBA from Wharton. Right, so I'm a very lucky person who is here to co-teach with these people. But in my case, it's only my passion about writing case studies that has helped me. Right, so in case someone like me who studied from a Punjabi school is working at a good institute, I think I can simply say with a lot of confidence that most of you already have a better foundation than me. So if I can be here, you can be too, can go to much better places. I will simply skip this video. So thanks a lot again, Aditya. Thanks a lot, Sakshi. I wish all the participants good luck to write very good case studies. Thank you very much. So I'm open for the questions in case we still have some time.
Thank you, Professor Puri. As we have already taken a few questions while you were presenting, so I would request those participants who would like to ask something to send your queries, send your questions to us, and we will pass on those questions to Professor Puri. Secondly, sir, I really appreciate the way you have explained the nitty-gritties, the fine details of case writing. Though we also had some training at IBS, but I must say that your explanations, your session has given us more clarity. And I am quite confident that this would be the situation with other participants also. So other than whatever case you have written and all accolades you have got, your life is also a case study for us. The way you started your journey, and I liked your very first, you know, argument that insulting sometimes is a best dose of motivation. And I think this point has been well taken by various administrators from various organizations. So, you know, this is how we all have learned, but your life is a good case study, how you started your journey and how you have written those number of cases and those good cases actually. So I thank you, sir, and in behalf of Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center for Leadership, Policy and Governance and IIM Ranchi, as you know, our expression of gratitude, we would like to present a memento for you because this is the COVID era. So this is, you know, online, but it will be sent to you, sir.
Thanks, Dr. Aditya. Thank you very much for your kind words. You are really very sweet person, I must say like that. Thanks a lot, Sakshi. I appreciate the way Sakshi has contacted me and then supported in the last 1.5 months. So thanks again, Sakshi. Thanks, Aditya. And I wish everyone, Professor Ashok, thank you very much. So I wish all the best to everyone here.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Just a question from my side. This is just an inquisitive question. Sorry, the session has started, ended, but just a question. So because I'm a faculty of economics and we do not have so many cases in economics, and as I can see, few of my students from economics have also joined. What suggestions do you would like to provide as in faculty to involve these cases in classes? Just
yes, you know, I missed saying that thing maybe when someone was giving introduction, because I was not sure whether how much time I will be having to finish this session. Sakshi, I will say that write a case studies on economics right now, I think is a very good opportunity. You're still into a virgin area. There are very few cases which are available for economics. Right. And I think you people can start collaborating with someone from the marketing area, because in case I'm talking about pricing strategy, right, while deciding the pricing strategy, lots of things are going to connect with the demand and supply situation and other things. Right. And again, you people are expert in the economics. So even our case studies, which are having some marketing perspective from pricing other things, can be much better. Right, you know, that's the reason that we teach students economics first, then other subjects many a time. We follow the strategy at AIM that students should be exposed to micro and macroeconomics first. We can put the other courses after that. Because unless I understand, you know, PESTEL is something, for example, we use in marketing cases. But PESTEL is basically based on economics, right? Lots of things are coming from the economics itself. We talk about quarter of five forces, few things are again coming from the economics. So there are very few cases which are available with a very good economics perspective. So the possibility of you getting a case publication is much higher than a new case study by me or anyone on marketing.
And so while teaching, how should we choose a good case in economics for teaching in the classrooms? Like when we are teaching micro and macro, what should be the criteria of choosing those cases in the classroom teaching?
So the first criteria which I use, Sakshi, is that it should not be a very long case. First thing which I keep in mind. After that thing, I get into, is this case study going to have enough information to give me an idea to, you know, discuss the topic which I want to cover in a particular class? And after that, if it can be a good case company, you know, Sakshi, I will simply say that one of my professor colleague at AIM, what she's doing, she's very, you know, renowned professor of economics here. She simply developed case studies. Okay, the government has introduced new income tax and those type of things. So she developed a case study that, okay, how this is going to impact the pricing strategy, how this is going to affect the consumer demand and other things. So you can simply have, maybe it's like just like this, that there's a manager of the company who was looking at the budget for 2021, and he was thinking about the possible impact this budget can have on their products, right? And then he is thinking about the possible demand scenarios and those type of things. I think something like that can be done in your area. And you can have one case study which is having part A, part B, part C, covering some of the things which you're going to cover in your course. So you will have three publications, three case publications with a single shot in that case. That's what one of my colleagues is doing here.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
So thank you again. Thanks, everyone. I wish you all the best. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We join at 11 again for the next session. Please do come back. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
चलिए ठीक था
यस सर
ठीक ठाक था
फॉर दिस नेक्स्ट सेशन वी नीड टू डू द टेस्टिंग फॉर द प्रदीप कन्ना प्लीज एनेबल योर वीडियो वी विल डू द
थैंक यू सर
थैंक यू प्रोफेसर थैंक्स फॉर दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी
मिस्टर प्रदीप कन्ना प्लीज एनेबल योर वीडियो
We'll take a break as of now and meet again at 11. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. You can take a break. Meanwhile, we will test it with the participant of the next session. Okay.